Orbiting vectors. Orbiting vectors. Check my mic. Two mics on today. Yeah, it's trouble with cheap microphones. I have a good microphone here. But we'll see how we do with these mics. It's a lot easier to get things coordinated than combobulated. But anyway, let's get over to this topic, orbiting vectors. Now, I've been working on this since the 60s, when I was getting the only education I could really afford, especially with my dyslexia. Nobody knew what it was back then, and I still haven't been tested for it. I know I have something. Anyway, probably dyslexia, probably really... Anyway, orbiting vectors. No, vectors. Escape velocity may have more to it than just the sense of traveling into orbit around a planet or anything. Even an asteroid, something with mass. It may also help us to understand, for example, the speed of the electron around a nucleus. How so? Our friends, the cosmologists, are scratching their heads at the prospect that their beloved atom, conceived of by the ancient Greeks, is really not the atom at all. In fact, there may not be an atom, or, as it were in modern hamburger distorted and enfeebled English, the smallest form of matter. So now, they got their catch-all phrase, quarks, as in Quarkie, baby. But you know, this really is an infinite universe, and it's expanding. So we can begin with the assumption that there is a magnitude beyond the galactic, and there is a mineatude beneath the quark. And I'll tell you right now, buddy, unless you've got some kind of microscope capable of seeing them, you can probably forget your idea of little wiggly filaments. Although it's a cute one, I must admit. What we're probably looking at here is a mineatude progression of form, a tendency to digress from the filamentary on the quasi-galactic scale, progressing to the spheroidal tendency of electrons orbiting a nuclear mass. And what experts may be reading below the quark may be an actual stretching of distance, giving a filamentary appearance to particular expansion faster than the speed of light. Hence, nuclear power, or energy equivalent to the speed of light times itself. Cosmologists tend to visualize these days a quote-unquote fabric of space which seems to be subject to distortion and, at times, even the occasional rupture But what they may actually be sensing is the slower exterior of magnitude tending to react in a sense that we would describe as gravitation, or a slower exterior tending to buckle and attract to a faster accelerating exterior, giving the illusion of gravitational force. And other similar type phenomenon of velocities, where the mineatude is faster than the magnitude. Or in other words, acceleration emanates from the epicenter. So we see that as all this expands outwards, as it were, there is an orbiting phenomena on a multi-galactic scale. There is an orbiting phenomenon that on a multi-galactic scale conforms to a filament type structurality. Boy, I mean, I tell you, you might be glad that I'm having this trouble reading with this dyslexia stuff, because it causes me to go slower and become more involved. How you read and how you speak is very important to being able to grasp something. In that sort of vein, theatrics is not amiss. We think of acting as sort of an exaggerating form of portraying something that really isn't there. But actually, acting can be used professionally or amateurishly. It still counts in order to examine something. So, let us continue. We're dealing with structurality here. A filament type structurality. It's a reaction to a buzz in the circles of cosmology back in around 2004 probably. And we may think of this as an extension of orbital velocity, that it is the tendency of galaxies to orbit the structural mass of the original epicenter, while at the same time conforming to a filamentary structure. This may also be what we might consider, or have considered in the olden days, so to speak, quote-unquote, gyroscopic force. That the gyroscopy, I must be mispronouncing that, I'm not used to saying that one. How would you really pronounce that? Gyroscopy? Probably. That the gyroscopy, pardon my pronunciation, of the galactic tends to exert a filamentary force, or a conformity to a magnitudinal expansion characteristic. But here on a solar scale in our frame of reference, we see that bodies tend to orbit one another in cooperative orbits, such as our moon around the Earth, or in dominant orbits, such as Titan around Saturn. Although it's still cooperative, but mass differentials there, I suppose. It reminds me of the joke of the sailor that went, of the sailor who went into orbit. Yes, a sailor who went into orbit. You know, it's not Captain Kirk. They treated their spaceships as objects of the U.S. Navy, whereas... Well, anyway. The sailor who went into orbit, he wasn't even in space. He was rowing a boat ashore when a shark swam up, got a little peppy, and took a chunk out of one of his oars. Well, that qualifies as an orbit. And that's close enough. I also went into orbit on a technicality. I actually went around the Earth twice, but along the jumbo jet highway, so to speak, making multiple landings. But that's kind of like an orbit in a way, isn't it? Even if it did take me almost 30 years, but I guess you have to really go into escape velocity the way Yuri did, the first guy who actually to orbit the Earth so long ago, to really qualify as a genuine orbiter. At least we can qualify as being composed of trillions of minitudinal orbits in our molecular makeup. I guess trillions is too low a number. Now, this involves mathematics in a certain way because we seem to be dealing with a progression here that can be calculated numerically, at least partially, enough to squeak by if it ever comes. As such things as practical applications of technology and so on. And it also involves geometry. The calculation of a magnitudinal proxemic to a mineatudinal and expansive body is a proportional deceleration away from the epicenter, causing it to travel in a tangent to an expanding sphere. As these bodies get larger and involve multiples of these orbits, they conform to the cosmic string phenomenon, so that their expansion and their tangential orbit. Yeah, believe it, I'm even having trouble pronouncing my own language, English. It's my mother tongue, and what I need is a tongue lash. Like, you know, that frog that grabs a can of beer out of midair? I think they banned that ad, didn't they? It's like, anyway. Okay, so they conform to the cosmic string phenomenon so that their expansion and their tangential orbitrations become filamentarized so as to lend credence to the concept that these contorted filaments give the impression that they are a part of a fabric. Now, look, you know, you got a fabric that implies a kind of like a wharf and a woof. You know, that means you have to have a cross of threads. So after, actually, fabric's really like a flat knot. I examined some of this phenomenon too, with my limited sense, but we won't get into that right now. About the unseen elements, the invisible, invisible aspects of the galaxy. But anyway. But what seems to be happening is, as a collective magnitude of mineatudinal orbitrations start to tend to function as a collective, they exhibit another tendency of velocities, heretofore thought of as magnetic force, or an alignment of expansive directions. Let me repeat that. An alignment of expansive directions which seem to increase velocities more in one direction than others. The proverbial refrigerator magnets seem to stick without glue to the side of the steel paneling on a fridge, when in reality the magnetized iron is aligned, as it were, toward the iron in the steel panels of the fridge, giving it a secondary gravitational phenomenon, or a departure from our spheroidal expansive tendency from the mineatudinal epicenter. My God. If I keep this up, I'm going to start saying nuclear instead of nuclear. Anyway, let me just repeat that. The proverbial refrigerator magnets seem to stick without glue to the side of the steel paneling on a fridge, which in reality, when in reality, the magnetized iron is aligned, as it were, toward the iron in the steel panels of the fridge, giving it a secondary gravitational phenomenon, or a departure from our spheroidal expansive tendency from the mineatudinal epicenter into a more cylindrical form, a more cylindrical form of gravitational. Let me see. I can do that with my hands. How about that? That's handy. Ouch. I keep bumping my arm on the chair next to me.
Refrigerator is stuck to. Boom.
No problem, buddy. Piece of cake. Oh, well, open the fridge. We got that in there. Oh. Yeah, okay. All right, so it's a departure from the spheroidal expansive tendency from the mineatudinal epicenter to the more cylindrical form of gravitational, or more properly, expansional primary and secondary velocities. You have, actually I didn't do that part yet. The primary velocity is the standard expansive tendency of all mass. It's kind of like as we went over the cosmic tide, as it were. But the secondary one is what sticks it to the fridge. It's not sticking to the fridge. It's going to the fridge. It's like, I tell you, man, check it out. It's going to the fridge. And the other way, faster than it's expanding anywhere else. How can that be? Shouldn't it change its shape? Yes, over time. You could be hanging around, you know, like a trillion years to see if the iron gets any bigger. Let's take a measure. Oh, yeah, it's probably, it must be a couple of quarks bigger than it was 3 million years ago. Oh, okay, write that down. Everybody's going to take note of that. Yeah, right. The only thing is like, duh. What? How come that thick on a fish? Well, I don't know. It's got space glue, you idiot. I don't know. It's like, I remember this ad for noodles, you know. They said, get to know what good is. And with the magnet, we have to say, get to know what glued is. Okay, I got like a couple of thousand puns lining up. So before we even go there, let me get back to this. Let's see. All right. Their primary and secondary velocities, expansional primary and secondary velocities. I mean, that could be a humanic oversimplification. It could be like thousands of different velocities, you know, which causes intermediary aspects such as a solar system to flatten. And more massive aspects, such as the cosmic conglomerate of galaxies, to filamentize. Filamentary, my dear Watson. Why is it Watson? Because you use the what. What are you talking about? Okay, space may expand faster along the length of a filament because of the secondary gravitation. Secondary. It's like, that's why they call it the Milky Way, because it's got a dairy in there, not a terry. I mean, if it was secondary, then it would be the paper way. Right? Paperwork way. Okay. So space may expand faster along the length of a filament because of the secondary gravitation it generates, and it could be noted that it may be the tendency of the cosmos to adjust to any action taking part within it. So the tangent of expansion of magnitudinal bodies reacting with mineatudinal I was younger when I wrote this. I could. Now I'm going by rote here. Let's try this again. So the tangent, and you know what a tangent is. That's a gentleman who goes walking in the sunlight and gets a tan. No. Okay, tangent of expansion of magnitudinal bodies reacting with mineatudinal epicentral expansion tends to appear as an orbit around a sphere. Now, it tends to appear as an orbit around a sphere, and as the outward expansion tends to minimize, being pushed by the expansion from the epicenter, objects seem to either adhere to a surface or form a secondary gravitational phenomenon where both primary and secondary cause it to form strings. Therefore, the strings tend to receive the buckling effect, similar to our experience as we seem pressed to the surface of the Earth in the presence of what appears to be gravitation. Although our buckling effect manifests as skeletization.
Don't knock it!
Okay. Or the calcific flocculation in interpretation of structural stress, which also appears very rapidly. My dyslexia kicked in. If I had a relative, I wouldn't kick Ken. Actually, I had pumpkin once, and that was a couple of relatives manning a pump. Okay. Okay. Although our buckling effect as human beings manifests as skeletalization, or the calcific flocculation in interpretation of structural stress, which also disappears very rapidly when these stresses are absent. Just go up into zero G for several months. You start to lose your bone mass. What, therefore, causes the exterior to keep from collapsing on the interior? There is more to space than the solid matter we can perceive. I went over this in my article in the Cosmos section, my website, paulholart.com, that dealt with the prospect of other non-material aspects of the cosmos also involved in this expansion, in fact, perhaps causing it, that also has substance but is non-material. This may even be the essence of the expansion. Let's see, essence of the expansion. And may be dragging matter out with it. Matter all the while composed of energy itself that has a uniform variable of graduated deceleration. A uniform variable of graduated deceleration, but on such a minimal degree that this translates into objects being attracted onto a planetary body, solar system material orbiting a star, elliptical bulging phenomenon in a galaxy, and ultimately the filamentation of extensive continuations of galactic materials or galaxies. Or should I say, quote unquote, ultimately, question mark? No. I should much rather say infinitely, quote unquote. And that applies to both magnitude and mineatude. I'm pausing here because I remembered the illustration I did. And it's hard to keep records here, you know. I've been a nomadic lifestyle, so... I can just vaguely remember I had a really good way to draw this magnitude and mineatude actually become a symbol like the infinity symbol, but it's different. I'll have to get back to that later, hopefully, somewhere in my memories. Okay. And that applies to both magnitude and mineatude. With that mineatude expanding from an infinite number of points. So you have another type of infinity here, not just infinity of distance, but you have infinity of expansion. It's not one central you know, Big Bang. This reminds me of the Big Bang Theory. What it was is a guy with long hair and he had to trim his bangs. Like a grad student who couldn't afford a haircut. Okay. So remember that mineatude expanding from an infinite number of points, So the universe is expanding from an infinite number of points. So what are those large objects noted by Hubble astronomers? That's the Hubble era that I was writing this in. And others. Way out at a seeming edge of the universe. Cosmic string conglomerates like the one we inhabit. Yarn balls of Milky Ways. If you want to put it into colloquialisms, yarn balls of Milky Ways. It's a lot bigger out there than lots of these smug little know-it-alls would like to admit. I mean, we know where the local Aristotelians are coming from. Always wanting to be the center of the universe. And naming everything after their polytheistic imaginations. That they are indeed the center of it all. And on, blah, blah, blah. The reality is that they are just as insignificant as the rest of us. So get over it. Enough of that incompetence. And when we go beyond that, beyond our material world of matter, into historic existences, completely different from the realm of matter, of quarks and galaxies and cosmic strings and so on, we can begin, for openers, kid, to actually be looking at an infinite number of existences. Each one behaving diametrically differently than the other. Now, that's a little more like it. A little more like the awesome reality we really exist in. So there are mathematics involved in calculating the constants of the universality of all observable and undiscovered forces such as gravitation, magnetism, gyroscopy, as well as calculation of the variables of UV, GD, or uniform variable of graduated deceleration. The uniform variable of graduated deceleration. Then there is the geometrically involved, which illustrates the tendency of substantial or non-substantial mass to expand in orbiting vectors at a given constant of a tangent from the aspect of primary expansion. In this, let's face it, in this existence, spin is everywhere.